Database normalization is one topic that is confusing for a lot of people. The reason is usage of terms which may sound complex initially, like multi-value attribute, non-prime attribute, partial dependency, functional transitive dependency, super key, candidate key, and similar terms. In this video series, we will learn normalization in an easy and effective way with real project examples. So let's get started. The standard definition says, normalization is a process of splitting a table or organizing a database to reduce data redundancy and to eliminate data anomalies. Let's understand this with an example. We have a table that contains the information of an employee and the department he or she belongs to. Now you can see that the department name info is redundant, and we will see HR for every person who works in the department ID 1. To reduce this data redundancy, we can split this dataset into two tables, a table containing department details, the ID and the name of the department, and another table containing the details of the employee along with the department he or she works for. Now the department name is not repeated, and this may not seem significant redundancy removal for this particular case, but imagine a table with a million employees and the gain would be significant. So when we talk about normalization, we talk about removing data redundancy, eliminating data anomalies, and one very important point that a lot of people miss out on is performance optimization. A lot of you may have heard that denormalization improves query performance. So in what world would normalization improve performance? Let's understand this in a little detail with this example. We have an employee table that maintains the employee details along with the designation the employee work on. Now the organization decides that instead of calling people sales executives, they will be called sales rep. With this table structure, we will have to update every row that contains the term sales executive or has designation ID 3. Now, if the same dataset was normalized, all we had to do was update a single row in designation table and the task would complete. The important thing to note here is that denormalization improves the select query performance but is a nightmare in case of frequent updates. Let's understand the second part of definition, which talks about data anomalies. Three types of anomalies are usually discussed: insert, update, and delete. Let's discuss them one by one. We have our employee department table listing the employees' names and the departments they work for. Now Paul, who works for the IT department, decides to leave the organization. Based on this table structure, since he was the only person in IT department at the moment, we will lose the information of IT department itself. This is called data anomaly, and trust me, in a real project, this almost never happens. No one designs their database in a way that deleting some data can lead to elimination of an unrelated area. Okay, let's talk about insert anomaly with the same table. A new employee, Rick, joins the organization, but he has not been assigned a department just yet. So we would try to insert employee ID 6, name Rick, and the other two fields will be null. Now, if the table has a check constraint checking that the department name cannot be null, we will get an error, and this is referred to as insertion anomaly. There are different ways to tackle such situations in denormalized database. We can either insert not assigned yet or park this row and insert it later when a department has been assigned to Rick. I have a video on late arriving dimensions or early arriving fact that explains a similar scenario. I will drop a link to that particular video. Finally, let's talk about update anomaly. Jane and Ron share the same department ID 1 and work in the HR department. Now, for some reason, the department ID of HR department is updated from 1 to 4. The update happens successfully for Jane, but not for Ron. Now, we cannot clearly identify if HR has the department number 1 or 4. This is referred to as update anomalies. Update anomalies may happen, but in a slightly different way. Let's understand that with this example. We have an employee table that contains ID, name, and city for all employees. This table acts as a source for employee department and employee team table. Now Sean moves from Dallas to Los Angeles. The information is updated in the team table, but is not updated in employee department table. If we only look at these two tables, we cannot be certain if Sean lives in LA or if he lives in Dallas. I refer to this as multiple versions of truth. The same information is present at multiple places and they are not in sync. And trust me guys, this happens in denormalized database more often than you would imagine. So if I have to summarize, when should we normalize the data? If data updates are frequent and is a priority, if the data selection is highly selective, the database is expected to have high concurrency, which means a large number of users will be accessing the data at the same time, you should go for data normalizations. The updates will be faster, there will be no data anomalies, and the data redundancy will be minimal. OLTP systems that are used for transactional processing of data are usually highly normalized. These systems are used in parallel by thousands of users. The queries are highly selective. For example, a customer will query only his or her account. A customer representative talking to another customer will check the details of only his or her account at a specific point of time. I will make another video on the differences between OLTP and OLAP that will further clarify some of the points we just discussed. Let's take another quick hypothetical example. We have 1 million customers in a bank who have done a fixed deposit for 1 year at the rate of 7%. The bank decides to change the rate to 6% with immediate effect. With this table structure, we will have to update 1 million rows, which can take time and can lead to update anomaly as well. So for such system, it is vital that we normalize our data. Let's quickly see what is denormalization. As the name suggests, it is opposite of normalization. It is a process of merging two or more related data sets, which introduces redundancy, but at the same time, it decreases the join complexity and increases the select performance, which is vital for OLAP and reporting systems. Denormalization is widely used in systems where the updates are not frequent and the focus is on aggregation of data for analysis instead of selective querying of data. I will make a separate video on denormalization and why it is important in OLAP system. Before we wrap up this video, let's do a quick recap. Normalization is a process of splitting or organizing of data to remove redundancy and to avoid data anomalies. And remember, OLTP systems are highly normalized while OLAP systems are usually denormalized. In the next video, we are going to talk about normal forms. I will make separate videos on denormalizations and difference between OLTP and OLAP systems. Once you are done with this series, I assure you that all parts of normalization and normal forms will be crystal clear to you. Thanks a lot guys for watching this video, and I will see you in the next one.